Welcome to Epic Space Models. In this episode, we will model the grid fin mechanism of the BFR booster. Let's get started. If you haven't seen it yet, I highly recommend that you pause this video and first watch the previous episode where I explain how the mechanism works. Otherwise, it might be a little bit difficult to understand what I am doing in this episode. So the first thing that I do is to create the cross section of the booster. So this is going to give me the boundary, the limit inside of which the mechanism has to fit in order to avoid collision with the mechanism of the other grid fin on both sides. So once I have the sketch for the booster, I add the cross section of the hub. So this is this disk at the middle of the screen. And once I have the cross section, I add a revolute joint so that it can rotate, and this corresponds to the pitch motion of the fin. Then I import the fins that I created in a previous episode, and I connect it to the hub. And when I connect it, I use again a revolute joint, and this creates the motion that allows the fin to be deployed from the folded configuration to the unfolded configuration. So as you can see, for the moment, I'm not drawing the actual 3D parts of the mechanism. I'm just creating a kind of skeleton with a wireframe model and use it to check that it is moving as expected before starting to create the parts with real volumes. So now I'm starting to create the hub. So the basic shape is a cylinder, but as you can see, at first, I'm going to have a lot of interferences between the fin and the hub. So I'm going to spend several minutes trimming this hub until I don't have any interferences with the fin anymore. So one of the things that is tricky here is that since the fin is moving when it is changing from the folded configuration to the unfolded configuration, we have to check for interferences at any position that the fin can have, not only in the folded position. So now you can see on the video that I'm slowly trimming the bottom half of the hub. So now in this configuration, I don't have any more interferences when the fin is folded. However, I'm still going to have interferences when the fin will be unfolded. So that's why I still have to trim like the sharp edges on both sides of the hub. So it's a bit tedious work, but you do want to spend time to correct all these interferences problems in the 3D model if you don't want to have bad surprise when it comes time to assemble the parts. So it looks big on the screen, but the mechanism is actually very tiny. I think that the diameter of the hub is maybe 12 or 13 millimeters. So yeah, it is more tiny than it looks like. Okay, now the interferences that are remaining are with the central hinge of the fin. So this is the hinge that is then connected to a linkage, the linkage being connected to the servo motor that actually makes the fin move. So now it seems like we don't have any more interferences in the folded configuration. But as you can see, when the fin rotates, the central hinge somehow goes inside of the hub. So we have to cut out a hole inside of the hub to make room for this central hinge and the linkage that we will create later in the video to move inside of the hub. So here, one of the things that you can use is to set the transparency of the parts to 50% so that you can see what's going on inside of the volumes when the parts are moving. So it seems like we are almost done now with the interference checking. Yeah, adding some fillet to have more rounded edges. And it seems like we are okay with the hub and the interfaces. So now I add the servo motor that control the motion of the grid fin from the folded and unfolded configuration. So at first, I'm going to spend time aligning the servo motor with the grid fin, because we can tweak the length of the linkage as we want, but they have to move in the same plane in order to be mechanically viable. So I make sure that the arm of the servo motor is in the same plane as the arm, as the hinge of the grid fin. Okay, seems like we are almost aligned. And of course, I make sure that the servo motor does not go outside of this plus minus 45 degree sector, because this would mean that it can collide with the mechanism of the other grid fins. So now that it's aligned, I create the linkage that connects the grid fin and the servo motor. And as you can see now, when the servo arm rotates, it pulls and pushes the linkage, and this makes the grid fin move. So now that we have this linkage and servo motor in place, we can start drawing the rest part, the remaining part of the hub. So here again, the basic shape is a circle, and we will hollow out the inside of this cylinder to make room for the linkage and the servo arm to move. So here again, I use the transparency setting of the parts to see what's going on inside. Okay, so now that we have the hub almost finished, we need to add some support structure, because so far the servo motor is kind of floating in mid-air, so we do need to have some support structure to have something to attach the servo motor to. This is why I add this flat section on the side of the servo motor, and this will act as a mount plate to which I will bolt the servo motor. So now I'm adding a bracket, which is also 3D printed. And when the bracket is in place, I will use it as a reference to cut holes inside the mount plate, so that I will just have then to use bolts to lock the servo motor in place. And as you can see, when the hub rotates, the servo motor swings up and down with the hub. So you do want to spend time to check that when the servo motor swings up and down, it does not collide with either the hull of the booster or the other mechanism on both sides. Now, the next thing that I'm doing is to cut out a hole on the side of the hub to make room for the head of the servo motor to fit. So the main part of the servo motor is outside the hub, but the head of the servo motor, the shaft, and the arm attached to it goes inside the hub. So as you can see, there is still one interference at the junction between the two cylinders that are making the hub. So I have to fix this problem. Okay, so now we are done with the mechanism that moves the fin from the folded position to the unfolded position. The next step is to create the second part of the mechanism, the one which rotates the fin around its pitch axis. So as I explained in the previous episode, here we are going to create a push-pull mechanism. So the servo motor will be placed below the hub, and it will be connected using a pair of linkages to the hub. So I add some tabs on the side of the hub, which will become the hinges to which the linkage will be attached, and then I import servo motor from the library. So as for the first servo motor, I'm going to spend time aligning the servo motor with the hub so that I can have a flat linkage connected the servo motor and the hub. And here again, I have to make sure that this servo motor fits inside of this 90 degree sector, otherwise it will collide with the servo motor of the other fins. So now it seems like we are almost aligned. Just make sure that the hub is not colliding when it swings up and down. And now I can start creating the linkage that connects the hub with the servomotor. And once I have one linkage, I just copy-paste it to create the other one. So as you can see, when the servomotor rotates, the fin and the hub and the servomotor attached to the hub rotates all together. So the next feature that I'm creating is a service hole on the side of the hub. So this will allow me to insert a screwdriver inside of the hub in order to tighten the small screw that is on the top of the servomotor. And finally, I add a small extrusion at the bottom of the hub, and this will be used to restrain the motion of the hub in the horizontal plane, because if we don't constrain it, it's going to move left and right when it is pushed and pulled by the servomotor below. Now the last thing that I do is to remove the overhangs that I have inside of the hub. So overhangs are structures that would need support material during the 3D print, because otherwise you would literally extrude plastic in midair. So the problem in this case is that if I have overhangs inside of the hub, I will need support material inside of the hub. And once the print is finished, it might be virtually impossible to remove those materials unless I use some kind of soluble support. So it's better if I can avoid the need for support material in the first place. And now we are done with the grid fin mechanism. Thank you for watching. In the next episode, we will insert this mechanism inside of the booster and design the interstage. So don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.